Good afternoon and welcome everyone. I'm Sue Saxon, Education Manager at Kaldor Public Art Projects, and I'm delighted to welcome you to our second forum in our wide-ranging series of public programs celebrating Project 28, Roman Ondák, at Parramatta Town Hall. I wish to acknowledge the Parramatta people as the traditional custodians of this land and pay my respects to their ancient culture and their elders past and present. I recognise the colonial heritage of Parramatta and acknowledge the contribution of the early settlers in laying the foundations of this great and historic city. I also pay my respects to the many migrants that have come to Parramatta and now call it home. All these elements make Parramatta what it is today. This project marks our third collaboration with Sydney Festival, but our first in Western Sydney. I want to thank everyone for making us feel very welcome in Parramatta, and especially thank the University of New England, headed by Rob Field in Parramatta, for their support in this event and also across our programs. Just a moment of housekeeping before we get into the meat of the day. The fire exits are to the front and the back, and the toilets can be accessed along that corridor. And while I'm at it, can I ask you just to silence your mobile phones? So in last week's insightful presentation by the Museum of Contemporary Art's Chief Curator, Rachel Kent, she discussed the looping structure of Roman Ondák's participatory art practice, the way he relocates and transforms social rituals and conventions, and then how the work finally disappears, just as the work at the Town Hall, which I hope you've all seen or will head to after this, will disappear, will paint over the walls of Measuring the Universe and dissemble the Terrace. And I hope you'll all come and see that, come and join us on Friday to see the last of that remarkable work. So Roman Ondák first began working with his family and friends when he felt there was a void which came out of the division of Czechoslovakia and the opening of Eastern Europe to the West. His work then loops out further from his friends and family to the community and the wider world, and in this case, of course, to Parramatta for a fortnight in 2014, before it returns to him. His work is different each time it is presented because of the context and the audiences who attend. So far, about 5,000 visitors have made their mark in Measuring the Universe, or bartered an item in swap. How do you define the attraction of this sort of participatory art? And does it herald or reflect the zeitgeist? Are we seeing a new, greater participation across social, cultural and political life? Today our panellists Rosie Dennis, David Capra, Tony Osborne and Rebecca Huntley, led by Robert Love, interrogate these ideas. We're very appreciative that Robert Love, director of Riverside Theatres, and one of Australia's most impressive creative forces, has kindly agreed to moderate the panel, as Michael D'Agostino is unable to attend for family reasons. And we especially thank Rosie Dennis, who reorganised her life briefly at such short notice to join the panel today. So I'd like to say a couple of words about Robert Love before I call him to begin the panel discussion. Following his work with the Seymour Centre, the State Theatre Company of South Australia, Sydney Theatre Company and Fox Studios, he joined the Riverside Theatres and reinvigorated the performance and events program. Robert's initiatives include the Big Laugh Comedy Festival, an expanded annual season of theatre, dance and opera, a schools and family program, the Big Notes Music Series, and his extended Parramatta programs of the Sydney Festival, Sydney Writers Festival and the Gay and Lesbian Mardi Gras. At Riverside, Robert has actively supported a number of important initiatives, including the Beyond the Square program, in the Arts for People with Disability, FORM, the True West and Breakout Theatre Development Programs and Paramasala. Please join me in welcoming Robert Love and our panellists today to explore what does happen when the audience becomes the artwork.
Here I am. Hello. I've just been described as an impressive force, so I hope I'm not Darth Vader. We hope. I'd also like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, who of course are the original dreamers, storytellers and singers, and where participation, I suppose, was natural and almost inherent in every sort of artistic expression. It was interesting that Sue just mentioned the idea that the Ondák works all disappear, and it's probably appropriate because I come from a performing arts background, but just about everything in the performing arts is ephemeral. It's there, lives in the moment, and then disappears, never to be seen again. So it's interesting that visual arts is now sort of trying the same idea. Now you see it, now you don't. I was to be a panellist, and my distinguished panel we have, we're all sitting down there. I'd have been there, but I'm not. I'm your moderator, and I'll endeavour to be moderate in my introductory comments today and in the presentation, which, as I said, comes to you very much from the perspective of someone who's worked almost entirely in performing arts organisations. Well, here we are, well into the Sydney Festival. There's still another week left for it to entertain, tantalise, intrigue, disturb, and perhaps even outrage us. There was a little bit of outrage the other night at Dido and Aeneas, a bit of audience participation, which I rather like. Someone sort of yelled from the audience, "What's this got to do with the opera?" And I have to say, once upon a time in Australia, you could hear those sort of things coming from audiences quite regularly. And it was sort of like almost unique. Someone was actually showing some displeasure at what they were actually seeing. One form of audience participation, not the only one. And in the context of this forum, of course, we're looking at how visual arts and performance engages and involves us in direct, active, tangible, and also in a visceral way. When the topic of the forum was announced, what happens when the audience becomes the artwork, I really did have no idea how this would resonate with so much of what the festival would offer us this January. More of that in a few minutes. Over the last 50 years, much has changed in Australia's understanding and practice of live performance and the visual arts. Until, say, 30 years ago, except for the all too few radical, subversive and pioneering experiments, art had been primarily static and ensconced in the gallery on well-lit walls or placed for viewing in the sculpture garden or sculpture gallery. And performance was mostly seen as theatre, predominantly text-based narratives on proscenium stages, with the fourth wall decisively positioned between the actors on stage, more often than not also brightly lit, like in a gallery, and the audience sitting in the dark in rows. A strange convention, you might say. At least you could walk around in the gallery, so that was a big positive, I thought, for the visual arts. Our gallery and theatre spaces were formal, mostly neutral, with the intent of showing what was on display. I guess it's the showing of what was on display to best advantage to a receptive but mainly passive audience. Of course, such spaces still dominate, but the innovations in the nature and style of the visual arts and performance of the last 50 years in Australia and even longer internationally are now part of the mainstream as much as are the more traditional forms of art and performance. This revolution has in turn resulted in the creation of new, flexible and adaptable venues and work being enacted and exhibited outdoors and in the community. Galleries now host performances and performance art and theatre venues now include, galleries now host performances and performance art on a fairly regular basis. I sometimes think actually the Art Gallery of New South Wales is almost like a performing arts centre in many ways. And theatre venues now include performance, art and installations in their programmes. Theatre performance is no longer predominantly text-based, illustrating character interaction through linear narratives. The classical unities of time, place, action are more often not observed or explored in new and intriguing ways. Dance, non-verbal expression and visual imagery are now as important as the spoken word. Performance may sequence in order or out of order. Performance may direct and control an audience's interpretation, understanding and participation, or leave that entirely to the audience's intuition and spontaneity to determine. And an audience engagement can be multidimensional on a scale from passive observation at one end to full-blown participation in the creation and performance of a work at the other end. While I'm going to focus on a few examples of what's happened in the world of performance over the last half century or so, it's worth noting, and the first two slides illustrate that the festivals of Bacchus in Rome and Dionysus in Greece are among the earliest examples of audience, performance, ritual and art all seemingly coming together in celebratory excess. Go to the second. Oh, do I do this here? Technology, always. Just press, there it is, we've got it now. Now I know what to do. If only more of that could happen. And all seeming to come together in celebratory excess. And that influence is felt in many ways, in many forms of performance and art today. Let's jump to just a few international and local examples where the boundaries between performance artists and audience have been radically broken down, and where audiences have become co-creators and participants in the performance. Now, none of these slides that follow are called gallery-friendly or gallery-ready. They're a little bit blurry, some of them, but they'll give you a bit of the flavour and the idea of the thing. In the USA, and well before people rushed on stage disrobing and dancing with the cast of the musical Hair, there was the groundbreaking work of Julian Beck and Judith Molina in a group called, totally got out of my brain now, no it hasn't, The Living Theatre, because it was a living theatre. You sort of get some idea of that. It's Julian Beck there with the long hair on the left hand side there. There was Peter Schumann's often, oh there's a little bit more, sorry, of the living theatre, where in essence the audience and the performance all come together in one sort of celebratory extravaganza. There was also Peter Schumann's often fiercely political bread and puppet theatre, specialising in large scale street parades, which obviously involved a large amount of community participation. There was Richard Schechter and his performance group in quite specifically encouraged audience members to join performances in the performance of work such as Dionysus 69. There you can sort of see that the space is certainly not a traditional space where audiences are sitting in rows, and where the performers and the audience come very close together. That particular one, Dionysus 69, do anyone know, does people know of that work? It's sort of like a seminal work in performing arts. In 1969, and there's some. I've got some books here. If you'd like to look at the end, and some of them are like beautiful photography of it, of the representation of these performances, quite extraordinary. Of course, there was also of more recent times. There's been the Blue Man Group, and the Blue Man Group, in a sort of a way, continues these sort of explorations of participation in the context of commercial theatre. Of course, there was also, in Poland, Jerzy Kotowski. People know of Jerzy Kotowski? Someone's heard of him? Anyone? Hands up if you've heard of Jerzy Kotowski. A few people. Very good. Again, someone... it's interesting. Can I ask, just quickly, who's actually from the performing arts world here? You might put yourself in that world. Who's from the visual arts world here? Ah, well, some of you are going to get a bit of an education in sort of what's been happening in performance. But our panellists will come back more perhaps to some of the visual arts explorations of similar sorts of audience participation. You can see it's quite austere, but I remember seeing Jerzy Kotowski in St Mary's Crypt somewhere in the 1970s. And it was a performance where we all sat on the ground. Jerzy Kotowski and his group always cleaned the venue too, so it had been scrubbed all the floorboards in the crypt there. And there was just candlelight, and we actually sat on the floor and watched the performance. So the way we actually related to it was really left to us, and we could move around, but we were definitely looking at it from sitting down low, looking up to the performance, and at times we sort of became involved in the performance. But how we viewed it was quite different again to sitting in rows in the theatre. Of course, another famous person in Britain was John Fox's Welfare State. The Welfare State was formed again in the sort of late 60s, no, probably in the 70s, and still going to this day. John Fox has only just retired from it about 3 or 4 years ago and continues his work in a more private capacity now. Again, this was explorations again using huge events which explored all sorts of people's contributions. There were engineers, musicians, sculptors, performers, poets and pyrotechnicians all coming together with the community to develop these site-specific, in a strange sort of way, performance installations, also involving a lot of parades. A lot of this work in the 70s and the 80s involved huge parades or sort of like perambulatory events. Of course, I'm going off tomorrow to see Fun Park up at Bidwell, where I think, again, we'll be actually on the move quite a bit and probably participating in various ways. And of course, you really can't ignore the visual and immersive work of La Fura del Baus. Does everyone know of their work? There's not very good slides, but again, I remember going to the Horden Pavilion and seeing a work there where, again, the audience was constantly on the move. And while we didn't directly participate, our perspective to the performance was constantly changing. And in a strange sort of way, it was as much an art event as a performance event. Of course, in Australia, there was Mike Mullins, and who established the performing space in the early 80s. And his No One characters and other projects changed significantly the Australian performance landscape from that time on. Quite controversial at the time, particularly his Lone Axe at Anzac, which was the one before, but they have been quite influential in determining what followed. There was the Sydney Front. I remember seeing a performance of Don Juan here. I saw it in Adelaide, where again you could see the audience, and the audience again actually could participate and become involved in the actual event itself. So we saw audiences mingling with the performances on the performance floor in what might be a kind of soiree or Don Giovanni's ball. These early manifestations and projects have been succeeded by more recent artists such as Deborah Pollard, Rosie Dennis, who's here today, Carlos Noem, Lee Wilson, and that's just to mention a few. And Sydney-based organisations, and I've only mentioned Sydney-based ones, Theatre Kantanka, Darling Patricia, Urban Theatre Projects, Version 1.0, Branch Nebula and Stalker. All are influenced by the visual arts, often incorporating technology of an ever-expanding variety and sophistication as the audience experience is constantly challenged and constantly interrogated. So let's get back to the Sydney Festival very quickly. I've seen quite a few performance pieces, and more than I anticipated, have had some sort of audience participation of varying degrees. And there's probably quite a few I haven't seen that have, but I'm amazed just how many actually do. There's some of them, the Duck, Box Wars, Band of Musicians, Kaput, Jazzomataz, IML Volio, the Beckett one that's at the Seymour Centre, called After the Fall. After the Fall? I'm not sure it's After the
All
Fall.
The fall.
All the Fall. All the Fall, that's right. And of course, the wonderful exhibition that's up at the Town Hall. Quick, I'm not going to comment too much about those, but just a little bit about some of them and the participation. I didn't actually mention also Oedipus Schmiedepus, which of course has been a little bit controversial as to the level of participation in that. The Duck, of course, you know, which has become sort of like the second year we've seen in the festival, in a strange sort of way has a participatory element. You know, the duck is there, but it's actually the photographing the duck and the act of being in the duck, and sometimes appearing in the photograph with the duck, that somehow adds a different sort of involvement than just the duck on its own. And of course, it does become essentially a photographic event to a large degree, as indeed I think has the stuff up at the Town Hall as well, where the photograph is almost as important as anything else. I think, Sue, you made some comments earlier about whether that actually distances and actually involves you or pushes you away from it. Maybe that could be part of the discussion later on. Box Wars, of course, we have had that here, here in Parramatta at the opening. Box Wars, where people get together and actually create the costumes, the props, the vehicles, and then in a sensational parade, the participants actually parade down the step and then actually have a war. Where the whole thing is destroyed, which is interesting, again, that a huge amount of effort over a week goes into creating this event, and then it's gone. Never seen there again. Broken up. People take little bits and pieces of it as mementos, but it doesn't actually sustain beyond the actual event itself. Band of Magicians I won't talk about, so there's lots of magic there. Kaput, which is the one up there, it's a non-verbal thing. It's all in mime. And has absolute. It's about a guy trying to show a film about love story, or a love story. And when I saw it, there was an extraordinary older woman who came out and actually worked with him, unknown obviously to him, and she hadn't known him, but somehow just gave of herself to the whole thing. So a whole new series of events began to happen in that particular activity. Jazzomataz, with the lovely. Well, there she is down the left there, Ali McGregor. The child in all of us loves to sing and dance. You know, it exhibits that wonderful thing with young children, and these were sort of like 2, 3, 4, 5 year olds, all singing and dancing. She comes off the stage, down into the audience. And the other wonderful thing is the parents get up and participate, but many of us just watch. It's an extraordinary thing happens. There's that wonderful callback thing that happens often in participation in the theatre. You know, started with the old pantomime thing, you know, do you know where he is? And everyone calls back, you know, and all that sort of thing. But as well, also in music, where quite often, you know, the idea of actually there's a refrain comes from the audience. And in this case, there was a lot of that going on, but as well, there was a lot of role play going on as well, particularly amongst the kids. There was one where that song, Where the Dog Barks, is it? Some sort of song, I don't really know it very well, but it was about dogs. And there was a wonderful last little thing where a couple of the kids had actually had lain down on the floor, turned into dogs, and were going to sleep. And there was Ali slowly patting them as they went to sleep. Now, we need more of those sort of events as adults to actually say we can actually participate at that sort of level. Oedipus Schmidibus, of course, a bit controversial. It's structured participation, not entirely working as part of the whole work. There's also a danger in some of this that you can be laughing at and not with the community of audience participants. And I'm sure most people working in this area are always trying to deal with that issue. And last night I went and saw I, Malvolio, which is basically Malvolio, well, an actor with a take on Twelfth Night around Malvolio, has some wonderful things which are pertinent to this discussion and saying. So the audience is totally involved. The lights are up all the way through. The audience is asked to take photographs and asked to actually Facebook them, and so it's sort of spreading out even further. And there was a wonderful moment when a chair collapsed and the actor actually very quickly said, bit of dead time while we deal with reality. Mm-hmm. And sometime that wonderful thing where the imagination of the art event and the reality intersect, interesting things begin to happen. He also made some pertinent things about, you know, theatre in itself. He said, Twelfth Night, a plot-driven play that no one finds remotely funny anymore, which I guess was a justification for why he created this new participatory event. Also said, theatres are bad things and they should close. And they say, theatre is educational in response to people telling me I'm insane. Very interesting event, and if you get a chance to go and see it, please do. He also made the point that this performance is totally analogue with no digital support, although he sort of slightly contradicted that by asking us to take lots of photographs. The Piper, which I don't think I've got, there isn't a picture of the Piper there. The Piper is by Darling Patricia, and again a structured and controlled audience participation event where parents and young children put headphones on and participate in the actual event. But there's also a degree of spontaneity allowed as well, to the extent that there was one lovely young child who was sort of like the straggler, who seemed to be getting all the instructions about 6 seconds later than anybody else, would always seem to be just behind, which added a whole sort of dimension to that performance that actually I don't think the Darley Patricia people had seen. And I'm sure every day when that performance happens, new things happen. And of course, last, I'd just like to mention All the Fall, the Beckett piece. When you are actually in the artwork, it's a radio play where you sit in that sort of space, mostly in darkness, but when the lights come on and you actually do open your eyes, although when you open you'll discover that most people are actually sitting like that, which is a very Beckettian image of everyone sort of, because the lights are bright and your eyes don't adjust very quickly, and suddenly, you know, you close them. And there's a lot of lines in it about a wind, sort of an arid wind. And you sort of, and when you look at it and you see it, you get the impression of everyone sitting in these rocking chairs and this arid wind has actually blown them away. The lighting, it is a thing about, it's an audio experience principally, but it also involves a lot of use of light. And the light shifts and changes as you sit in your rocking chair and as you participate to some degree by rocking. Sometimes rocking to the very metronomic rhythm of some of the dialogue. A really interesting piece, and something where really you are immersed in the artwork and are actually, in a sense, passive but very actively engaged with it. So, what happens when the audience becomes the artwork? Well, just these are my observations, and I'm sure you'll all have your own, and I hope, and I'm sure the panelists will say more about it. The audience is connected to the performance in a more meaningful way. The audience has a greater sense of ownership and increased commitment, can be part of the work, and are not excluded from the work. The audience better comprehends and enjoys the work and its context. The audience quite importantly, releases its imagination in an active and playful way, more akin to that engaged during childhood. The audience exchanges, and of course, in the Ondák works, exchange is a very important part, and that sort of tangible physical exchange. But in a sense, the audience exchanges with the subject and the content on multi levels where participation actually occurs. And the audience is engaged viscerally and sensually as well as intellectually. The work itself? Well, the work communicates more effectively. The work gains in relevance, integrity, and authenticity. The work is more responsive and immediate to its audience. The work is etched, and I must say that Beckett piece is etched in my memory, more effectively in the audience's memory. The work is often open to unscripted surprise, danger, and revelation. And sometimes those revelations are things that are inherent in the piece but are not necessarily overt or easily seen unless there is that participatory factor going on. And most importantly, the work is liberated. It's actually liberated. I've just about come to the end. I've spent far too much time. I was going to say moderate and brief, but I probably haven't been as brief as I should have been. But just a quick couple of images. This was Box Wars in Parramatta on Church Street, just up the road. And for those who were there, it was a fantastic event. And this was just the parade. This wasn't actually what happened when they finally got into Prince Alfred Park. This was last night. We were invited to actually take photographs of that. That's Grace, who allowed the actor to do lots of wordplay around coup de grace. And as you can see, that was definitely his. Another participant, and there were other examples of where audiences were asked to come out and actually participate in the performance. And of course, there's our famous duck, which again, that sort of, the slide up in the far left-hand side, that in a strange sort of way is actually those people sitting around that tree are participating in that particular art piece in their own way. And of course, you can see it can be photographed in so many ways, so many angles, and so many places. To finish off, and to really come back to your point, a lot of these things actually are in the moment and they disappear. So I'll finish off in the words of Tom Stoppard in Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Now you see me, now you... Oh, don't. Get down to the real deal, which is our panellists. And I'm delighted to introduce, first up is Rosie Dennis. And Rosie came in, I think, on about 1 day or 2 days' notice. Rosie, prior to joining Urban Theatre Projects in 2012, has presented at more than 25 festivals across Central Europe, the United Kingdom, Australia, and New Zealand. She has received a number of new works commissions, including Channel 4 in the United Kingdom, ABC TV, to choreograph and perform Quietly Collapsed. Arnolfini, is that right? Pronounced that correctly? In the UK, to write and perform Fraudulent Behaviour. This is a really hard one. Massenturm Kunsthaus in Germany, to write and perform No Entry. Camertown Art Centre, to write and direct Life as We Know It. And of course, in 2011, you'll all remember the Sydney Festivals presented Rosie's Driven to New Pastures and the award-winning Minto Live, which Rosie conceived and curated for Campbelltown Arts Centre. In the same year, Rosie was awarded the Rex Cranform Theatre Scholarship. I didn't mention Rex, and of course, he's been a great pioneer in actually this whole area of work in the performing arts. Rosie was awarded this scholarship and acknowledges and celebrates new and original voices in Australian theatre. In 2012, she was awarded an Australia Council Cultural Leadership Grant. And as a leader in this area, I welcome her to talk to us.
Well, do you need, could I just talk like this? Do you think that would be all right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because that would maybe suit me a bit better. So thank you, Robert. That was good and, international, Australian kind of acknowledgement of this kind of work with performance focus. And like Sue and Robert, I just want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we stand. And can you please do the quack quack when it's 10 minutes? Because I don't have notes, so I'll just chat. And as Robert said, I'm the current Artistic Director of Urban Theatre Projects, and we're, you know, a pretty little company based in Bankstown. We're the only professional independent theatre company in Western Sydney that's not a, that doesn't have a youth focus. And we've been around for 31 years, and I've been with the company for one. I'm just a little bit nervous being up here, so I'll just, like, you know, roll with that. And I'm just going to speak pretty much from an artist point of view, actually, because I've been in this world of making this kind of work, I don't know, for maybe 10 years now or something like that. And a really big turning point in my life, actually, was when I was going to have a child. And it's funny, you know, I just looked around. I had toured a lot internationally, and I looked around and I thought, God, I'm always touring and I'm in these black boxes and it's really frustrating. And I'm in one black box and another black box, and how do I ever meet anyone? You know, I'm just a performing monkey, actually. I go and I do it, I go to a foyer, I'm not interested. And so I came up with an idea for a work which was called Downtown, which this image is from. Hello and welcome. And at the same time I came up with this idea, I also knew I was going to be having a baby. And I looked around kind of the landscape, I thought, well, a lot of people make work that's, I don't know, that's maybe looking at the darker side of things. Sadness, loss, isolation. I was reading lots of artists' work that were looking at loneliness and all that kind of stuff. And they're really valid things and things that affect us all. But I became really inspired to make work that was joy-filled. I really went, wow, how amazing. My life's going to change. I'm going to have a child. I want to find the joy in life, and I want to connect, actually. So I shifted my artistic practice. And I came up with this idea called Downtown. And it was a work that was commissioned by Performance Space, and it was me in residence with Key Space for 2.5 or 3 weeks. And I set myself the challenge of going on the street every single day and just talking to strangers, which was really hard because, like, what do you do? I mean, how are you going? And, you know, anyway, I went to Martin Place and I did a day there, and I went to King Street, and I went in different parts of Sydney, and I would just try and strike up conversations with people at bus stops and, yeah, all sorts of things. Anyway, it was all good. It was very hard, you know, to put myself out there and just talk to people. But that's what I wanted the work to be. And the works was brilliant. I'm just being really inarticulate. It was just really great though, because through this work Downtown, I had this whole exchange with Yoko Ono, which is just really weird. And I'll get to how that happened, because I simultaneously decided to write a story while I was meeting all these people, because I wanted to meet people and talk about life and talk about, you know, just find points that we could connect, you know, see each other in each other's stories and that kind of thing. And at the same time, I was writing this story about Yoko Ono, and I just thought, I'll email her. So I did. And I said, I'm writing this story about you and an imaginary dog. Are you, I just, as a courtesy, wanted to check that you were fine. I'm going to be doing it in Sydney. And, yeah, are you okay if I mention you in the story? Anyway, she emailed me back and said, that's fine. And people think to this day that that is a lie, but it's actually not. Because I took the work to Brisbane and I emailed Yoko again. And it was the time when the floods were happening in Brisbane. And she emailed me back and said, that's fine. And can you pass on this message to the people of Brisbane? So she had a really specific message about all the floods that had happened. The work's been to Brussels. It's been to Melbourne. So it was something that people really enjoyed, having this artist in residence that was just putting themselves out on the street and chit-chatting. Couldn't have made the work if I didn't have people to talk to, really. Anyway, that was all just spontaneous. So hello and welcome. I'm Rosie Dennis. I just went, yeah, I'm really pretty happy meeting people. I love that. So then I got invited to go to Campbelltown Arts Centre. And Lisa Havilah, as with Fiona Winning at Performance Space, has been a really fantastic supporter of my work. Unbelievable belief in me as an artist, and I wouldn't be here today if I hadn't had some really significant opportunities from those two women. So Lisa found out I was doing this work in Waterloo, actually, because I lived right next to social housing, and I really wanted to write a show that was kind of like, it doesn't really matter if you live in public housing, social housing, actually, you know, we've all got things in our life, we're all part of a family. We've all got a home, or we don't have a home, but we understand that notion of home. And some of my friends wouldn't come and visit us, because we lived right next to a whole lot of social housing. And even though the people living in social housing were predominantly old people, they were worried about their cars. And I went, right, I'm going to write a show about that. And not specifically about that, so it was didactic, you know, but just explore that and challenge people's notions of what it's like to be in social housing. And then Lisa heard about it and said, come out to Minto, Rosie, and have a residency in this, like, community hub. I'm like, okay, I'll do it. So I bought a bike. I went to the hub. I was like, you know, how you going, everyone? I'll just be here for a bit. And I thought, what am I going to do? Like, I just don't know anyone here. So I went to a notice board and I pulled down all the group contacts. And I said, okay, what groups go on in Minto? I'm just going to go to all the groups. And I'm just going to meet people. I'm going to tell them I'm an artist. And I'm here and I'm writing a show and this is what it's about. And they can either go, great, let's have a chat. Or they'll go, right, that's weird. Go back to the city. But, you know, they didn't. Anyway, so this photo is of me and a woman called June Hickey and her dog Harry. And the first group I went to was the walking group, had about like 12 people in it, and June, after the first day, said, do you want to come and have a cuppa? And I said, I do. So June and I now, I met with her just this week, and we're on our third show together. I just briefed her on the new show that we're going to do. It's a talk show between her and I. And so we just hung out, and after about 6 months, I realised I had to change the show. I was writing a solo, because I was a solo before, and I went, wow, I can't do this show now that I'm in Minto. Now that I've met all these people through all these groups, I need someone with me to do it. So I said to June, do you want to have a crack? And she was 72 and had never performed, had been the local junk mail delivery person in Minto, and she went, I'll do it. And so I talked to Lisa, you know, do we have enough money in the budget to pay her award wage and all that kind of stuff as a pensioner? And she's like, yeah, we do. So anyway, we did it. And we did it in a little church hall in Minto. And it had afternoon tea for people. And I just remember these people in Minto came up to me and said, you know, like, wow, great. The next thing you do, can I do it with you? And I went, okay, that's all I need. And anyway, we were really lucky. Sydney Festival came and they really liked the show and bought it. And it ended up going up to the Seymour Centre. And you know, it's not enough just to have one show in Sydney Festival, so I thought, let's do two. So that same year, I also curated Minto Live. And Minto Live was in the pipeline before Driven to New Pastures happened. But I just, when that man came up to me and specifically said, I'll do the next show with you, I thought, okay, what can I do? Like, I don't know why I felt responsible. It wasn't that I felt responsible, but I just think Minto was a suburb with such a bad reputation, you know, and it was under major redevelopment. People were losing their houses. So I don't know how many people know about Minto, and there's Minto Ed's Claymore, full-on social housing, 90% of the suburb social housing. I think Ed's or Claymore is 98% social housing. So it was a time in the government, I think it was Ref Shorgi, where they decided to just put all the low socioeconomic people together because they thought that'll be good. And, you know, it totally wasn't good. It was a really, you know, it just wasn't a wise decision. And so what they're doing now is they're just knocking down all those old social housing places, which were a terrible design as well, because they were based on a US design called the Radburn House, and it meant all your business was pretty much out on the street. So if you were trying to raise your children, you know, not to hear kind of really filthy language or see things that maybe were inappropriate because you didn't want that, it was pretty impossible to protect your kids from that. And Minto was a suburb known for spontaneous fires, so fridges would go up, washing machines, cars, all this kind of stuff. It was crazy, had a really bad reputation. But like in my first week, I was invited for a cup of tea, so I knew that there was this enormous sense of pride in this suburb that they wanted to tell a different story. So I thought, okay, I can do that. So I worked for 18 months, but all up, I guess I'd been in Minto then for three years, you know. And this kind of work about participation and working with non-artists is about consistency. You know, you can't drop in, parachute in, I don't know what it's called exactly, but you can't drop in and drop out. You have to kind of say, if you're going to have a cup of tea, have a cup of tea. Or if you're going to, I don't know, your word is your word, really. A handshake is what does it. And so you've just, you know, you've just got to be consistent when you're working with non-artists, because they don't understand conceptually this whole practice that's going on for you. So to make Minto live, I'm Greek Australian. I just set up my office, not in the arts centre or anything like that. I set up my office in the Greek fish and chip shop, Nick and Nick, and that was it. You know, at first I was that weird artist, but then we started getting news stories. You know, we were in the Herald, the Australian, the local paper, the TV, and all of a sudden their espresso machine was getting the newspaper stories put up. I was always there. Everyone thought I had heaps of money, you know, but I didn't. So I've got a little Minto Live clip. Do you want to see it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll get to that. Okay, so this is just like little 3 minutes. So we just started in a car park, and this is Uncle Ivan, you know, was really fantastic. He did a smoking ceremony every night, and even though traditionally...
On behalf of their ancestors, their elders, and the people of those, and the people of those ancestors and elders of the Dharawal and their clans, mobs, I respect you. I acknowledge us and I welcome you here today.
Just going to pause it. So we walked 1 kilometre through the streets of Minto. We went from where all the social housing was, this is all the new development where all the houses have been knocked down and rebuilt. And the new people that were buying in were predominantly Bangladeshis. So it was a real also cultural kind of, you know, from a lot of Indigenous people, a lot of low socioeconomic white Australians to now, you know, like the fish and chip shop was changing to be a spice shop kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And this work that people are walking through the street for now was called Street Dance. It was by Lone Twin. Local residents did a solo, or you'll see the one that we're going to do is a family, a dance out the front of their house. So I just wanted to kind of, you know, so people walked from house to house for these dances. We had probably like 400 people walk through. I'm just going to pause it again because I think Rebecca later on is going to talk about what this kind of experience, how it, is that right? You like fill in that sentence. That man and his family, just to kind of give a little bit of a background, like I door knocked to get the people to do this, right? It's not easy. But, you know, when you want to do something, I guess you just do anything to make it happen, right? And so that man, I door knocked and he didn't want to do it. And anyway, I was going around on my Sunday, door knocked, and this woman whose name I can't remember, she said, come in and have a Fanta. And I said, okay. And she said, who from our community is dancing? And I said, no one. And it was like mid-December, and I knew that Christmas was coming, and I knew Lone Twin were coming from the UK on the 7th of January. And she said, leave it with me, I'll find you a family because we have to be part of this. So, you know, just then I knew in that conversation that would be okay because she would find someone, because she understood how important it was. The family that she found, that man's got a CCTV camera out the front of his house. When Minto was getting redeveloped, there were a lot of thugs who were up on the new part, and there was, it was often in the news for people getting bashed and for guard dogs even getting injured, for police guard dogs. And he was one of the men who was severely beaten. And so for him to come full circle and go, no, this is where I am in Australia now, I'm an Australian, and this is really important for me to do it, you know, he didn't, it was a big deal for his, in his kind of, I don't know, I'm not describing it very well, but yeah, to move on from what had happened and just to go, I'm going to dance at the front of my house with my family now, you know, and celebrate, actually, celebrate living here and celebrate this future that I've got for my family. I don't know how many people donated fabric, but Nicole was making that string for months and then she crocheted it into a very large kind of installation or textiles installation. It was later on at Campton Art Centre. If you kind of get shocked by things, don't watch this next little bit, okay? Because she's going to explode. That was just Hetain Patel, who was there just before with those two Samoan men. I saw Hetain's work in the UK on a tour once, and I thought that he was really good about cultural identity and understanding who you are. I offered him to come to Australia, and I said, here's the deal, though. I don't have a theatre. I've got a hill. And would you consider coming on your own for 6 weeks and working with two local Samoan men and teaching them your show? And he said, let me think about it. And he did. So those men, untrained performers, worked with Hetain 10 till 6 every day, learnt all of the tin-tin-ta-tin-tin-tin, and did it with him. And it was like, you know, it was pretty amazing. A lot of generosity around. Anyway, and this is Gwendolyn Robin. And she's a Belgian artist, totally unreal. All her work is about pyrotechnics. So it's not participatory. But it's unreal. I guess it was really important for me to have something in there that was, like, I knew the history of the suburb, and a lot of people did who lived there, and it was like, well, how can I somehow in this event reference what's been before? You know, of all of that time of the fire, of the deaths with fires, of all this kind of stuff. And it was really hard to get that through, but people got why Gwendolyn was there, who lived locally. Anyway, I'm out of time, I've gone over. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much, Rosie. That was terrific. I was actually at the live Minto, and but quite a wonderful experience. What's interesting out of that, though, is the idea of a remote artist, the weirdo, versus the close-up and personal, have-a-cuppa friend. Mm. And I think that's the future. You know, artists need to be friends with their audience, and for that audience then to become a participant at various levels. Anyway, now we're going to move on to out of the world of performance into the world of visual art. So for all of you visual artist world people, you might feel more comfortable now. And I don't know whether David blows things up. He might, but I know he's out there blowing up concepts and ideas and the norms. David is an artist working across multiple platforms, including sculpture and performance. His solo exhibitions include Dancing with David, Art Mart Sydney in 2013, Birthing Things in the Spirit, First Draft Gallery in Sydney in 2011, New Intercessions at the Lock Up Cultural Centre Newcastle in 2012. Selected group exhibitions include Nighttime No. 13, Genuine Facts at the Performance Space in Sydney, Helen Lempriere, Travelling Art Scholarship Art Space Sydney 2011. He has been the curator of High and Lofty, the Ecclesiastical Banner Project at Parramatta Artist Studios in 2011. And from 2012 through to 2013, although now we're in 2014, I guess it's 2014, he was the director of First Draft and a recipient of the Australian Council for the Arts New Work Grant. David is currently completing a Master of Fine Arts and, of course, is working on the Fun Park project that happens in Bidwell tonight and tomorrow. So he rushes away from here to an opening occasion. David, welcome.
Okay, hello everyone. I just wanted to also begin with acknowledging the traditional owners of the land in which we stand. So I am a contemporary artist, I think, and I work often in... when I talk about my work, I use the term intercession, and intercession is basically a term that is used more regularly within the church community, and it really is just processes geared around healing, and maybe that will become a little bit more clearer as I talk about my work. But I wanted to, I do work in performance, so I've done things called the Ministry of Handshakes, which is inspired by Elizabeth, and Elizabeth is a Nigerian woman who arrived in Australia in the 90s, and she believes that she must go and shake people's hands on public transport, predominantly from Asheville to Campbelltown after her night shift. And I encountered Elizabeth, and I was in awe of what she was doing. In fact, she was turning the train into theatre. It was buzzing and it was extraordinary. And I wanted that. So I made a 2.5 meter arm prop that I shake people's hands with in public transport. Not public transport, that's what Elizabeth does, mainly within Sydney streets. I also perform with Tina, my 3-year-old sausage dog. But today I'm going to actually talk mainly about my last project that took place in November, and it was called Birthing Things in the Spirit, The Water Birth. It took place in partnership with Campbelltown Arts Centre, part of their dance program. And I was really interested in the idea of birthing, carrying something, and I feel that's what I do as an artist. I always feel pregnant with something and I have the belly to match, and I thought, you know, I'd really like to birth something. So I approached Campbelltown, and we found the right pool to do so, which is in Eagle Vale. And so I'll talk about the process. Basically, I hijacked the Aquafit aerobics class every Wednesday, and so I really identified with what Rosie said about, you know, pursuing joy in her work, and that's something that I tend to kind of gravitate towards. And so these ladies have been part of this Aquafit team for about 17 years, and some of them there's Gwen, who makes dolls. There is Jenny, who really is into dog breeding and dancing with dogs, which is a love that I also share. There were a pair of twins that were 87 years old, including one, Wilna, who actually would cut her hair in a bob cut so her hair wouldn't. This is Gwen here. So her hair wouldn't get wet every day, every time that she came to class. And a big part of this work was really getting to know these ladies. And I mean, I had a huge anxiety actually coming into this project, particularly because these ladies, they really represented to me, well, my grandmother. And you know, I actually don't share my contemporary art practice with my grandmother because I find it quite inaccessible, or I'm a bit shy and a little bit embarrassed about it. So I had this strange kind of, you know, that anxiety coming into the project. And then I also And I also, you know, was really careful. I didn't know when it was time to reveal that what we were taking part in was actually going to be a water birth. I mean, it sounded quite messy, and I didn't want to scare these ladies, you know. So I took time to, we all connected over Esther Williams. Now, Esther Williams was in the 50s and 60s a big synchronized swimmer, MGM movie star that would make these fantastic Technicolor extravaganzas. And I used to, this is June here, and I used to watch them growing up, and I was really looking at, you know, having something that resembled what Esther did in the water, but also was really interested in Annette Kellerman, who was an Australian swimmer in the 20s, and she actually is said to have invented synchronized swimming, and she's a Marrickville woman, and she went into Hollywood and cracked the vaudeville scene and would perform in tanks across America. She was a huge superstar that isn't very well known, and she actually donated in the 70s to the Opera House her entire collection of things, including Esther Williams's costume, which is now at the Powerhouse Museum collection. And so the process looked like going into the water, taking part in their class for the first half, and then the next half was me developing a routine with them, and one that was comfortable. That one that they felt comfortable. Now, Jenny right at the front was the instructor, and I couldn't have done this project without her enthusiasm. She was just extraordinary. I loved Jenny. And so then there was tea and there was coffee, and it felt very real what was happening. And I think it was the third week, and I said, no, I'm going to do it. I'm going to get out the promotional flyer and say, well, this is what we're doing. We're doing a water birth. And they were like, oh, good, okay, moving along. And I was really quite surprised at their response. You know, it was important that they did trust me, I think, before kind of dropping the bombshell of, you know, this highly conceptual idea that seemed quite bonkers, really. And in talking about the anxiety, I spoke to a few people about it, Michael D'Agostino at Campbelltown Arts Centre. I said, Michael, I'm really worried here. What should I be? He said, just you'll be fine. They'll trust you, you know. And I also spoke to Mark Shorter, who is Rennie Codgers, and he performed with Sweet Tonic at Campbelltown. And he said, really, what you're doing is making something beautiful. And, you know, a lot of the time you have to just express to who you're working with that you're not making fun of them. You're just working alongside them, and you want to create something real. We might stop and have a little... I'm yet to see this, actually. It's a bit anxious. But we'll watch a bit of... we'll watch a minute of the performance here. So I actually come from a community cultural development background as well, which I find very interesting. I think the, you know, visual arts and CCD processes are quite different some of the times. So I've taken on a few ways of engaging with people and kind of bringing that into my practice. And I might just talk briefly about Fun Park, which is happening this weekend. And I'm working with Dorothy Overton, and Dorothy Overton is one of the country's largest Oz memorabilia collectors. And I have been a member of the International Wizard of Oz Club since 6, and I love the Wizard of Oz, and it's terribly important to me. So so if you go to Fun Park, you'll find a room that's filled with her memorabilia and a little bit of mine, actually, a lot of mine, and And I think that it really is, you know, it's quite nice to see what's happened. We've also also included Brian, who Brian Lull, and he actually is the director of the Wizard of Oz Funland in Campbelltown, which is basically it's a Wizard of Oz theme park in an industrial area, in this large shed space in Campbelltown, and it's become less and less about the Wizard of Oz, and it's more about community and just witnessing the conversations. It can be quite embarrassing, like the level of detail. You know, yesterday Ruth died, and Ruth was the second last living munchkin in the Wizard of Oz, and who would know that only Jerry survives, and he's 98. He's part of the Lollipop Guild. So you know, it's about these conversations and connecting over something that we all have in common, but making it, you know, art as well. And right. I think that's really all. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, David. I mean, as much as Rosie's thing was about friendship, the artist and the friendship of the participants, I mean, David's clearly, you know, his processes are geared around healing, joy and trust. So they all sort of go together. We actually earlier today thought we'd actually sort of celebrate the duck by having a quack, quack, quack to stop people talking. And you can see we just love talking, all of us. We just keep going. So we're running a little bit over time. So I'd say we're going to be going to about 8:30. So if you need to text someone to say you're running late, this is the opportunity to do it. And that's not to say to our next speakers that you need to be quacked off earlier than anyone else, because we've all had our bit. So hopefully the audience will stay tuned, and because it's been interesting just actually seeing the different sorts of things when happening. Our next speaker is, of course, someone who's been up in the town hall for the last week, another week to go, regularly engaging and exchanging with people, actually taking the art of participation right here to the centre of Parramatta, in, I suppose, Parramatta's most public hall, which has been terrific. It's Tony Osborne. Tony's a theatre, dance, vocal and sound artist who's been improvising performance for 25 years. That's a lot of improvisation. That's a lot of stress. But a lot of friendship, trust and healing, perhaps. We'll find out. He's been a co-curator of Sydney improvisation events, Rushing for the Sloth and Whippet, and regularly creates performance work in collaboration with a variety of theatre, sound and dance practitioners. He's also known for his short and full-length improvised theatre, as well as solo vocal electronic work. He's a choreographer, an actor and a long-standing vocalist with Splinter Orchestra and the Sydney University Graduate Choir. Since 2012, he's toured East Coast Australia with the improvisational theatre show 241 Years, performed Life's... Oh, no, sorry, that's the name, Life 241
support.
Years.
Life Support was the other piece.
And the other piece is Life Support.
Yeah.
Okay. In Melbourne's Dance Massive Festival and appeared in Sydney's Whippet and Melbourne's Up the Ante. Please welcome Tony Osborne.
Thank you, Robert. Hello, everyone. I thought I'd just start asking, asking you, all of you, to please let me know if you, first of all, has anyone here been to 13 Rooms to see the SWAT? And how many of you have come back to Parramatta and seen SWAT again? And how many people have seen SWAT here at all? Okay, so a few of you. Just, yeah, okay. Who hasn't seen SWAP at all? Okay. Just so I know. How many of you are familiar with what we do? I feel like I represent a few people. I'm the guy they ask because I've been on the project for the longest, but there's three other guys doing the Parramatta performance, and there was three of us did the SWAP room at 13 Rooms in April last year. And I thought I'd just ask, because this is an unusual, they've chosen people as performers, and mostly we're performers in a theatre context, and this is quite unusual to be, for me especially, and I think for many of the other guys to be put directly with the public in an improv situation where you have to follow a few simple instructions. And I've been asked to speak about swap, so I probably should explain to you what swap is. Roman Ondark's instructions are very simple. We were asked simply to engage everyone that enters the space and decide what they offer as a swap, whether or not it's appropriate. So we do, we are the ultimate arbiters of the swapping. There is an object on the table. We sit at the table and we talk to people about swapping. We talk about the value of objects and we talk about material things. And it's very rich. Some very rich conversations occur. But before I'm probably going to talk about myself for about the next 8 minutes. So I'd like to talk to you. I'd like to just tell you what the other guys, I've asked the other guys to give me a quick impression of their experience. So Takin Pock is one of the performers at Parramatta, and from Monday you'll be able to see him. We're all sharing shifts. TK's text to me was starting out expecting to draw on skills of auctioneering and aggressive salesmanship, but more like a practitioner of the dark arts engaged in the act of transformation, relying on pure will and momentum, re-morph the object into something else. So he's seeing himself as a bit of a magician there, I think. Thomas is in the room. And his impression so far has been great, to see people say they have nothing of interest and then sift through their bags. And when I see that look on their face, the look that goes, yes, I found something, that's when I get excited. And then I see the object and hear the story. I love understanding how people value their objects. It's been great. I haven't enjoyed a day yet. I haven't not enjoyed a day yet. And with one more week to go, I'm definitely keen to see what objects I can get on the table. Have we got a technical issue?
We're not trying to tell you to stop early.
No.
Really not.
Am I still coming across the PO?
Yes.
Okay. So I feel like this is kind of housekeeping, and I hope you'll bear with me. Charles is the other performer, and Charles wrote to. This is what gave me the idea of having their voices in this talk. Charles is probably out of the three new guys that are doing this, he's been so enthusiastic. And let me see, he wrote to me the other day. Okay, maybe we'll come back to that. The other person to mention is Kirk Page, who did 13 rooms with me. And we were given a day to work in the room at 13 rooms, where they were setting the space and the staff, the support staff and the attendants were testing out what was going to happen before the main audience arrived. And so we got a day to kind of workshop what we were doing, because as performers we were giving them these few instructions and then we had to work out how we were going to deal with that. And of course we had no idea until the real punters came in, but we kind of workshopped it a bit together, Kirk and I, and I really want to acknowledge the development that happened between us to both feel confident about the work. And what Kirk says about swap, and part of the reason he's not here in this season, is that it's just too terrifying. He's an actor. You would have seen him perhaps on Redfern Now recently. He's a fabulous actor and a beautiful guy. And he just found it terrifying until the moment when he entered the room and the people came, and then he's fine. And he did it beautifully. He was great at swap. So a vote of thanks to Kirk for helping me also to find out what this was about. As you heard, I improvise. That's kind of what I do, and I've come back to be doing all the things that I trained in and practiced in over the last God knows how many years, from music to theatre to dance to improvising, and now a mixture of all those three. People ask me to work because of all those different things. And swap engaged me in something that I would never have thought would have been a part of my artistic life, which is the thing that's paid my rent for the last 40 years, which is selling stuff. And I find, oddly, all the skills I have as an improvising performer and the skills I've gained as a guy who sells stuff over the phone have come together to make an artwork and to help me engage with people in an artistic way. And thanks, Kaldor, because it's crazy, but I always thought that was a kind of a fairly useless thing that was just a pragmatic thing that I wasn't gaining that much skill from, but it's proved not to be the case. And I think it was Robert mentioned something about we should be friends with our audience, and I've made a few new friends over the last year. I've made a lot of new friends. In fact, they've come back to see me in Parramatta. I use the term friends a little bit loosely. But my latest new friend is Sam from Canada. He's a guy that came into the swap room yesterday. He's on holiday here, I think. And I'll just tell you some anecdotes, because that's what they wanted me to do, I think. Yeah, Sue, that's good.
And we'd love to show you.
You'd love to show that? Okay.
Yeah, can we show your video?
You want to see the video now? Yeah. Okay, I'm being curated. Isn't that good?
Thank you very much. Okay, look, we've got $5. Who'll give me $10 for that?
$10.
Is it time to swap over a couple of people?
If you want to do that, if you have a bit of scratch, it could be worth $10.
I made a promise about the money, and I
put $2.
Have you finished your artwork, Andrew? Oh my goodness, this was made in the room, commissioned by me, by Andrew. Can you sign it, please, Andrew? You sign on the back.
No, it's on the bottom one, you're probably going to walk over the
hand. Oh, so that's your signature. This is a freshly commissioned, diagrammatic piece of art done in this room by Andrew for me. And I believe in artists being paid for their work. So I'm going to swap this $5 for Pam's art. Who would like to swap something for this? You're still on with the coffee cup thing. What is that?
$2 scratch.
You could win $10.
You mean it's not scratch?
It's not scratch.
No, I was going to give it to my friend, but
I'm
just
talking. She's an artist
and she's a chef.
I think I've upsized you now, aren't I? I think I've upgraded you. You were waiting for a watch or something, weren't you?
No, I want something more, you know, personal.
Oh, okay. I think I've got the wrong impression of you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think you actually got a bit more swapping spirit than I thought. Now, I'm going to swap this for a scratch. It's a $2 scratchy.
Yeah.
So what's the biggest prize that you can win with that?
$50,000
you can win. That's all. We're going to put that on the table. This lady's been waiting around for something good, and she's got the personally... okay, Andrew, about that? Yeah, okay, that lady has your... Look, she's giving it to her friends a gift. That is so sweet. For an unused scratchy. That is so good. Thanks for being a great audience. Cheers.
2 minutes, okay. Oh, what shall I tell you? Look, I could tell you 1,000 stories, I really could, but I'll see if I can rush through a really special morning that happened back at 13 Rooms. I'm not going to get to comparing, really, because 13 Rooms and Parramatta, they've been very different, mainly because of the way the space is set up, and people can escape at Parramatta. And as you saw there, there was a group of people in a room with the door closed, and they all engage. So what happens is a little community gets created every time the room changes, or morphs, because sometimes only part of the room changes over. Whereas at Parramatta, people can sidle off to the side and then just disappear around the corner. And we don't have quite the same critical mass of people coming through. So that's a major difference. There we are, I've told them that. But in 13 Rooms, and this has happened to a lesser extent at Parramatta, amazing swaps. I'm in a dilemma now whether I should tell you about a recent swap yesterday that was wonderful.
Yeah.
I think maybe we'll tell you the Parramatta story. Just that I know you'd all be interested in how I swapped $50 for $100, and then what happened with that money over the morning. It was about 8 swaps, and it If you want to find out about that, come and see me afterwards. I'm glad to tell that story. But yesterday, I swapped. I think I had a $10 bill on the table, and Alejandro and Catalina came in. They'd been shopping. They had shopping bags, and Catalina, I spoke to them for a while. They had pretty good English, but I could tell it took them a while to understand what the hell was going on. I think they'd been shepherded in by the festival people out in the mall. And when she realised what we were doing, she went, "Oh, well, I have a bag of strawberries here. I'll swap that for the $10. And it was 5 punnets of strawberries, which is a really lovely, lovely thing to have on the table. And because it's in a bag, I can call it one object, so that's great. And quite a generous thing if you can find something you want to swap. So I had the bag of strawberries. And it took a while because we're the arbiters of value. And so people try and scam us all the time in the room. So, you know, got a used Band-Aid here. It means a lot to me, it belonged to my mother. But, you know, we can usually tell when they're giving us a porky. And so that took a while for me to come up with something, or for someone to come up with something I was interested in. And what it ended up being was a lady had a bracelet and she was lovely. And why that swap happened was why the same reasons many swaps happen is that people form a relationship with me, and I often manage to get a few people to stay at Parramatta, and we engage with the meaning of objects and why one thing isn't worth the value of that thing that's on the table, and there's a lot of talk goes on around that. And this is the joyous thing for us as the interpreters, is that we get to just relate to people all day and meet people that, you know, we would never normally meet, and hear what their attitudes and ideas are. Anyway, that's what did go through. With the bracelet this lady had in her bag, she hadn't found the right clothing for it. She'd never used it. It was brand new, and she'd been carrying it around and never worn it. But it was a three-way swap, and there was a guy who was definitely trying to scam me. And then in the end, he just went, "Ah, it's just swapping." I convinced him it was just swapping. He said, "I'll give you $20 for the bracelet if you swap it." So I quickly swapped the bracelet for the strawberries. The man gave me $20. And the lady got her bracelet back because he said, "Here, give me a punnet of strawberries and you can have your bracelet back." So she ended up giving him 2 punnets of strawberries and getting the bracelet back. Then we had $20. Now money, people's eyes go, "I want the money." So everyone wants to swap something for $20. They're very interested when there's money, when it gets up to that level. And of course, I don't let it go very quickly because we want something, we want to hear some stories. I mean, in the swap room, objects, usually the interesting objects and the ones we end up swapping, either of amazing value, like the Swiss Army knife I just swapped before I came here, or they have a story attached to them. And so a very shy girl came in with her mother, and she was kind of hiding behind her mum. And the mum says, "Oh, okay, yeah, well," you know, she was very engaged, she's a very nice lady, and we're talking about what she might swap. And then she said, what have you got? And I said to the girl, she was 16, very sweet kid, "What have you got in your purse?" And I say this to everyone, "Come on, empty your bag out, let's have a look." "Oh, I haven't got anything." "Let's have a look." And she said, "Well, I've got this." And it was the King of Diamonds, just a very normal playing card, a little bit moth-eaten, looked like it'd been in there for a while. I said, "How long have you had it?" She said, "I've had it for 8 years in my purse." And I asked her why. And the reason she'd had it in there for 8 years was she belonged to a friendship group that had formed 8 years ago. And they'd grown to 11 of them, all girls except for one boy. And the group, as a group, they decided to name everyone with a nickname in the group, but keep it a secret from them. So everyone in the group has a nickname, but the other 10 know, but they don't. And every year on their birthday, they give them an object that is a clue to their nickname. And they have to try and guess it. And in the 8 years, only one person in the group has guessed her name. And the prize is, if you do guess your nickname, then you're taken out by the rest of the group to an event of your choice. And so the King of Diamonds was the hint. When I heard that story, I just handed the $20 over to this. It was just the most wonderful thing. I thought those kids are going to be friends for life. And my time's up. So there you go. That's a story from Swaziland. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. It was interesting, Tony's comment about the artist actor as a magician, you know, sort of unravelling secrets and surprises, unveiling the unexpected. And the other interesting thing is that the discussion starts in the artwork, unlike often what used to happen in the theatre, where the discussion used to start after the performance. You know, a cup of coffee afterwards, just have a glass of wine. The discussion starts actually in the performance, and I'm sure it continues after it as well, but it's just an interesting thing. Our next speaker is Rebecca Huntley. Rebecca, I don't know, would you describe yourself as an artist?
Social researcher.
I know. She's a researcher. She's an author, so she has to have some sense. She's a writer. With a background in publishing, academia, and politics. She holds degrees in law and film studies, so she knows lots about how to keep it legal and how to get it down on celluloid or down digitally. And a PhD in gender studies. She's definitely probably the best educated person of all of the panelists. I'm not sure, we'll see. And is the executive director of the Mind and Mood Report, now in its 35th year. She is one of Australia's foremost commentators on social and consumer trends, the author of numerous books, a feature writer for Vogue Australia, and a columnist for VRW. And most recently, she's joining ABC as the RN Drive presenter on Fridays. Please welcome Rebecca Huntley.
This is an extraordinary moment. There's artists, you know, I'm on a panel with artists, all who have PowerPoint presentations, and I'm a researcher with no PowerPoint presentation.
That's great.
It's extraordinary. Social researchers don't leave their house without a PowerPoint presentation. I have had both an extremely personal response to the Roman Ondák exhibition, as well as an intellectual response. And before I talk to you about the responses that I've had, I want to explain to you what it is that I do and how I do it. I'm a social and market researcher. I'm not one of those that rings you at 6:15 at night in the middle of lunch or middle of dinner to ask you about toilet paper. What I do, and I've been doing it now for 8 years, is I go out and I sit in somebody's living room with a friendship group. It could be a whole lot of 18-year-old girls who've just finished the HSC. Could be a lot of 70-year-old men who used to be in the police force together and now go bowling. I go to people's living rooms, I go to their workplaces, their pubs, their cafes, their backyards. I once did a group in a bikie shed. Everybody was smoking marijuana. I was glad I got out alive. And I sit with them and I say to them, what have you been talking about? And they tell me what they've been talking about. And then myself and all the other researchers that I work with a small team of dedicated women. We come back and we work out, well, what is the national conversation that we've been listening to over that week telling us about Australia? I call myself Australia's biggest eavesdropper who doesn't work for ASIO. And the nature of the work that I conduct, it gives me a unique kind of opportunity to have a think about what matters to people. And the first thing I want to talk about a bit is my experience with the swap, my reaction to swap. And it was great for Tony to kind of tell people, for people who haven't seen it, what it's about. The first thing that I thought about swap that really connected with the research that I've been doing recently is that since the global financial crisis, there's been a renewed resurgent interest in Australians about the idea of secondhand goods and swapping things for things rather than going out and buying new things. There's lots of things that has powered that along, environmental, social, consumer trends that have powered that along. But I think most of it is this idea about people wanting to get away from purely corporate spaces and wanting to get rid of an object that might still be useful and get something new. The idea that might be have an environmental benefit as well. And so what we've seen is a lots and lots of markets, but I think one of the things that's interesting is to see the extent to which we've seen that play out in the digital sphere with things like Gumtree, people swapping stuff on social forums like Facebook. And I just discovered a new digital device recently called TwoShare, which allows people to, with their mobile phone, allows people to kind of avoid having to throw a whole lot of stuff out and swapping useful items like clothes and toys and books and so forth. We put about 4 trillion kilograms of waste into landfill every year. So there is a kind of a social, there's a kind of a buzz you get about getting rid of something that's still useful that you don't have for somebody else. I think too as well about Australians' capacity to barter. I mean, interestingly, one of the first studies I did 8 years ago was a study about Australians' attitudes to service. And there was a big discussion then amongst the groups about whether Australians are good at haggling. And a lot of the groups, a lot of people would say, look, haggling and bartering is something that WOGs do, it's something that the Asians do. This is the idea that ethnic people barter, but Australians don't. Australians pay the price. That's changing now, which is interesting. And the other thing that reminds me too about that, there has always been a traditional nervousness amongst Australians about questioning things, about saying, is that worth it, and kind of bartering in that way. We're not very comfortable with it. I remember once doing a negotiation course a couple of years ago, and the guy who taught us about negotiating, about the art of negotiation, said to me, of all the people in the world, Australians and New Zealanders are the worst at negotiating and the worst at bartering, worse than anybody else, because we've always been an affluent country with space. We've never had to push our way forward and haggle. And the people that are best at negotiating tend to be people who live in relatively poor and cramped spaces because they've constantly got to find a way to accommodate the space and the people around them. I thought that was interesting. I had an experience with Tony in the swap exhibition, which was interesting. It was a bit different than I thought it was going to be. It felt quite an intense experience, quite competitive, quite intimidating. I felt the pressure of the group. And, you know, it was very much like being in a high-powered market experience with that that kind of sense of having to having to really fight for your fight for your place in the space. And that made me think a little bit after that experience about when people in the research that I do talk about the experience of swapping one object for another. And I thought particularly about, we've done a lot of work on with SBS and with other organisations around Australians' attitudes to multiculturalism. And it's not particularly easy research to do because there's still a lot of discomfort in Australia with the idea of multiculturalism and the impact that it has on the so-called Australian way of life. But we also do interesting research with first, second and third generation migrant communities. And one of the things that really struck me reviewing that work just after going to see SWOP and being involved in that was that one of the more transformative moments between people, perhaps people who are already living in the host community, so people who've been here for a long time, and a new migrant, is the idea that they might swap something. So I remember doing an interview once with a Greek woman who'd been here for many years, and she said, we moved into an area where there weren't a lot of Greek people, and we felt isolated. And then one day we just had all these tomatoes, and I remember just passing the tomatoes over to my Aussie neighbour over the fence, and she said thank you. And then a couple of days later she had extra lamingtons and she brought them around and she said, I don't know if you've ever tried lamingtons. And that was one of just so many stories about this idea that you might exchange something. Now it goes against this idea, there was no evaluation about, oh, she gave me a kilo of tomatoes, therefore I'm only going to give her 6 lamingtons. It's not an idea about it's equal, it's an idea that the very active exchange of something that's important to me and I have a surplus of will give to you. And there were lots and lots of those stories. For a book I did on food about 6 years ago, I spent some time in a migrant resource centre in Western Melbourne. It was an area in which there was a lot of tension between new African migrants and the established migrants who'd been there for a long time from Turkish and Greek communities. A lot of tension. The Migrant Resource Centre came up with a wonderful idea to bring together the women every month for a lunch, and one of the communities would make the food in that lunch, and the idea that they would swap recipes. And it became a place in which these women both swapped recipes, they swapped children's clothes. And again, it was that opportunity to connect around the swapping of a good. A relationship can be created. But how you engage in that experience is so crucial. And thinking about Shua, thinking about Rosie's, the Bangladeshi family, I mean, that dance was really, you know, a gift and a buying into that community and saying that we're an important part of that. So it doesn't always have to be a thing, it can be something else. The other thing I want to mention before, how am I going for time? I might talk for the next 30, 40 minutes. No, I'm only going to talk in 5 minutes because you might want to ask us questions. The other thing that I wanted to talk about was measuring the universe. So I walked into the exhibition and there's a quote from the artist on the wall. It talks about, Roman Ondák talks about being fascinated with the mystery of how people behave, who and what they love and why, and the mystery of everyday life. And that's essentially my job, is kind of working out why people behave the way they do. I did have a profound personal reaction to this. It almost seemed like an artistic expression of what I'm required to do in my work. Over the last 8 years, I have literally sat in front of thousands and thousands of Australians. I'm in field every 4 weeks to 6 weeks in a different part of Australia. And unlike a quantitative researcher, unlike somebody who conducts polls or surveys, I'm not about massive amounts of people and spewing it out in terms of a number. I'm about the voices of lots of individuals that kind of build up to a cacophony in my head, and I actually do remember almost every single one of them. I don't think you should have a mental disease doing this job. I think it could really be the onset of some kind of bipolar disease. So part of what I have to do, which is quite difficult, is measure the sentiment of an individual but also take the temperature of a collective. And when you look at SWAP and how it develops, you see the mark of all these individuals at different points in their life, at different heights for some of them will be shorter. It's good that they don't actually measure girth, that would be really quite problematic. But also it creates one beautiful wave, one complex picture, and there's movement within. It's beautiful to see, and it just reminds me of how difficult the work is, because part of what I have to do is generalise. You know, if you ever hear me on the radio, I'll say, Australians feel this way or Australians feel that way. And some people connect with that. That's how I feel that way. People say, I'm an Australian and I don't feel that way. I can't get lost in the detail. I've got to see that bigger picture. It's quite hard. And so I think that measuring the universe will be something that exists in my head as I continue to die and do this work ongoing. I just want to make 2 points before I end. And the first is, one of the things I was asked to reflect on is what might SWAP in a place like Parramatta, what might SWAP and also things like measuring the universe, what might it give us about a picture of Western Sydney? And I certainly think it's bound to measure, it has already measured the multicultural and the dynamic nature of this community. But I think one of the things I always question is that how do we understand what Western Sydney is? Western Sydney gets talked about by politicians in a really kind of problematic way as a place that is antagonistic to asylum seekers, represents the worst kind of politics of envy, is a place that the Labor Party has to reclaim. We've got to get the votes of the battlers and people in Western Sydney. I live in the inner west. I can't tell you the number of dinner parties people have said, well, I feel this way, but I wonder how they feel in Western Sydney. Or I get people to say, what are people like in Western Sydney? And I'm like, what do you mean what people like in Western Sydney? And they get really offended when I said, they're exactly like you. They've got kids, they go to work, they're watching My Kitchen Rules. What do you think they're like? So I think this imagined place that is Western Sydney exists for everybody else other than the people in Western Sydney. I have never ever done a group, and I've done literally hundreds of groups. I've never done a group in Western Sydney, probably over my time, probably done about 40 or 50, where they ever say, I'm from Western Sydney and this is how I feel. They identify with their community. It's very strange. So we have to stop talking about the idea of Western Sydney. I think that's pretty important. But I just want to end up now to talk a bit about what might measuring the universe reflect. It certainly reflects a moment in time in this community. I think people attracted to public art, people who are open to just wandering into a space, They might be shopping, they might have the luxury of shopping, they might be attracted to a free spectacle. Families at a particular stage of development. What I love about a lot of the stuff that the Sydney Festival does is there's a multi-generational aspect to it, and it's not just for parents, it can also be for children. But I think it must attract people who are united in a desire to leave their mark, even if it's just a little scrawl in a larger space. Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The duck can finally quack.
We might need to let
David.
David, I need to go.
David, do you need to go? So if you have a pressing question for David, you can go to the fun park and you'll find him answering them there.
That's right.
In amongst his memorabilia and others.
Thank you very much.
Rebecca. Rebecca has interesting comments about Western Sydney. I agree, Western Sydney is a funny sort of place that's in the mind of people's imaginations for people who don't live here. Although I think there is a reason why sometimes Western Sydney still needs to be a concept, because without that, then essentially I think it is discriminated against. It is actually sort of put in another thing by the people who live away from the place.
I think there can be a strategic deployment of Western Sydney, but I worry when it becomes, it stands for stuff that it doesn't actually really stand for.
I agree with that. I think people have all sorts of preconceptions, and most of which are just not true at all. I thought it was interesting how you were saying about how that swapping thing is not just a commodity transfer or transaction, it actually sort of like it allows and permits other things to actually come out. And whether you wanted to actually say something about that.
I mean, I think the very power of swapping is that it's anti-commodification. It's about people saying they want to get away a bit from this idea that they might buy something completely new with money. And in some ways, there's some interesting exchanges. I mean, Tony's talked about some interesting exchanges where people, when money comes on the table. But sometimes I think money can potentially narrow the conversation, and people will immediately think, would I pay $10 for this, or should I have paid $10 for this, rather than thinking about that exchange of objects. But in the work that we do, the most powerful swapping comes when two very different and probably very unequal things are being swapped and something else is being created out of that.
Well, it's interesting, you go into people's living rooms and you actually sit down and have these discussions. If Tony went into that living room and had the same discussion, one is research and one is an artwork, or are they the same thing? Or when does it actually change? Deborah Pollard, I know, said, you know, that sometimes, I read something that led into all of this that said that when you actually take the butcher out of the butcher shop and put the butcher into a sort of a space where you wouldn't expect them, they suddenly take on a whole new level of interest and are actually sort of like become larger than their real life. They become something else.
Well, Tony's the arbiter in this kind of exchange. It's a central part of the work. One of the things that we do when we go into people's living rooms and spend time with them is that we actually try and disappear as much as possible. Like, I don't drive my car there, I take a taxi, I dress down, I sit in the corner, I kind of try and make myself quite small. And that's quite important because people are always looking to tell you what they think you want to know, which is absolutely the opposite of what we do. We want them to feel like we have no preconceived ideas about what we want to get out of the conversation. And in fact, a perfect group is one in which I talk for 5 minutes and not at all for an hour and a half, and they almost forget that I'm there. So it's a very different dynamic. And I don't look very artistic when I do it. I look very daggy.
Rosie, do you, when you actually commence those conversations, do you start with a sort of an agenda, or are they actually free form and very open and you have no preconception? In other words, in a strange sort of way, the artist disappears before the artwork begins to be constructed.
Is that a question for Tony or me?
No, it's for Rosie, actually.
Oh, Rosie, sorry.
But everybody can contribute to it because it's quite an interesting.
I don't really. I hardly ever talk about art, I've got to say, with people. Like, there's a project that we're just starting now, and it's like another Greek man, and I just go for coffee with him every fortnight. And this week, his best friend, who'd known him since he was 8, Charlie, came, and we just talked about boats the whole time. So they just have a chat, and I just chip in, really, over coffee. so I don't,
That's a relatively neutral.
It's just neutral. Activity. You've got to, I think, to build trust, or what Rebecca was saying, if you kind of just want, it's so true, people in that first instance, they say what they think you want to hear. And so you've got to just be pretty relaxed with your own energy to just be communicating on this really physiological level, that you're not looking for anything fancy. You know, you just want to have a chat, and you've got to work out how much of yourself do you need to share for them to kind of, so it's fair, so the exchange is fair.
If you come in with an aggressive agenda, then people will respond as they do to any kind of, if you come in with an aggressive agenda, people will respond to it quite quickly in that way, and then what you're getting is other kinds of research or something else. You're getting something else. And then you're also blocking off the opportunity of serendipity. And the other thing that you're stopping is the flow that can happen when people who really love each other and who are drunk, in a lot of cases. What happens, which is that what you discover is the extraordinary proximity of conversation, of conversation topics.
Yeah.
So people might talk about one thing, they might talk about what's happening in their local school, but then they might move to what's happening in their local park, or that might move to talking about Julia Gillard, and it's the links between where they move from one to another that tells you as much about the psychology of people as is a kind of barrage of questions that you might have asked yourself.
That's really interesting, because that happens in the swap room, where we ostensibly are talking about the value of things, that those conversations nearly always leech into the meaning of things, and people talk about what they hold dear, and then they talk about their lives.
And so you've been all very patient out there. There's an opportunity for you to ask a few questions, if you'd like to ask any of the panel some questions. Far away. Questions?
I had a question for Rosie. Yeah.
When you're establishing those relationships, in a way you're doing research.
Totally.
In mind, thinking about a performative outcome. Yeah. So do you have a very phenomenal memory, so that you can, with some accuracy and integrity, kind of translate what you're receiving? Do you take notes, which immediately put you in a position of kind of looking at them as a subject or object? And I'm just interested in how you navigate that, and how you keep the integrity to those conversations, and how then more sort of translates into a creative or performative act at the end.
I very rarely would take notes face to face, because we're just having a chat. And usually what I'll do is, as soon as I've said see ya, I'll just quickly write down everything that I can remember. Because unlike Rebecca, I am an artist, so I love kind of listening to what they've all said, and I go so hard from that personal to stretch it out to be the universal, because that's what I love. I love that you can be in Minto Social Housing or Bankstown small business forever for your whole life, but then there's something really universal about your life as well. So I just scroll down whatever I can, but I love the slippage of that. Because at the end of the day, I want to create a fiction, because I don't do documentary or verbatim theatre. Sometimes, though, I will ask if I can take my phone out, because I know they'll say something that I'll just forget because of the level of detail. And I'll ask them, do you mind if I write that down, because I want to look it up later. But pretty rarely, it's after the chat that we just, then I just write it down. There's only one of me.
Right. Another question for anyone? Mm. Okay, well, I think we're coming to the end, so I might hand you back to Sue, but I'd like to thank you for being so patient. We all have lots to say. But I hope you'll go out for the rest of the festival and have a look at the wonderful Ondák exhibition, but also make a friend of an artist, because they all need friends.
Thank you all for coming today, and please, if you haven't been measured, if you haven't experienced Roman Ondák's work, come to the Town Hall after this or tomorrow, because we also have for the rest of this week, every day at 1 o'clock, our talk swap measure series, where we do ask people who are prepared to say that they're from the Western Sydney region to respond to the exhibition for 10 or 15 minutes and give their various views. Tomorrow we'll have Kaya Simon, Western Sydney Wanderers star striker, speaking about her responses to ideas and measurement. So I hope to see you at the exhibition, and thank you again for coming today.
Thank you.